Jeff Cote. I'm a boater as well. Wanted to boat since I was, I think it's my first thought that I actually remember is wanting a boat. I wanted a sailboat. I think I was 3.5, 4 years old. And I moved out to British Columbia for boating, and I actually imagine always boating in a fjord. That's what, for me, it was in the palm trees or the sandy beaches. It was actually British Columbia. And I had never been here, never seen it, probably seen images of it, but I just, I really crave that kind of like big open space with very few people. And I figured probably when I was a kid that who would want to go in a place where it was cold and rainy and big trees and rocky shorelines. And so, yeah, and I moved out here and then came out for boating. So I hope today what we're gonna get, or you're gonna get, is I have a passion for boating, and electrical is a way to enable you to do what you want. So with that, we're gonna get started. Just ask everyone to have cell phones off, please, just to eliminate distractions. So feel free to ask questions. If the questions are long-winded answers, and some topics, and there is no such thing as a bad question or a stupid question, I truly believe that. Some questions are easy to answer and some are harder to answer. And if I feel that there's content that's gonna be explained that later, I might say, let's hold it off, or maybe hold those questions maybe at the end of when we're done the slides, because it's gonna be more involved and it might be a 5-minute answer. So, but please, lift your hand and feel free to ask questions as we move along, so to make sure that nobody's feeling that they're not understanding the material as we cover it. Take lots of notes and do drawings, and that's fine. The slides are gonna be available. We're gonna post them up and we're gonna share them, probably not by the end of today, but I will have all the slides available to you in a PDF format. So this is kind of the schedule. We're gonna get started now, and then we're gonna take a break in about an hour and 15 from now. And then we're gonna go for another about hour till about 12:30, take a lunch break, and then this is how we're gonna be dividing the day. So I'd like to, before we get started, I'd like to ask a little bit about each individual, one of us in the room, to go through a little bit about who you are, your boat, your electrical knowledge and experience, what you hope to learn from this class, and let's do it for the sake of time. Let's try to keep it to about a minute, please. And so, yeah, maybe start with Wendy.
My name is Wendy Bryan, and I live on a boat in Falls Creek in Spruce Harbor Marina. My electrical knowledge and experience is about 30 to 40 to 50 years old, when I actually did wire a 5-bedroom house myself.
Oh.
So it's pretty rusty.
Well, at least you have some real-world experience. Nicole?
Oh, hi. Nicole Speckmeyer. This is my sister, Shannon. We bought a boat together in the summer.
The first and most important thing with electrical, before I move on to the next slide, I think, is to always doubt yourself. There's no room to have bravado when you do electrical. There's no... I actually... would encourage everyone to be very, very cautious and have a quest to have found the right answer. There's no such thing as it's good enough with electrical. There is only one right answer. And to think that you can get away with doing 80% of it or 90% of it, if that's your attitude, it's like you shouldn't be doing electrical. You really shouldn't. You have to care absolutely about doing everything right. And if you're not with electrical, it doesn't matter what you did right, it's what you did wrong. And only one wrong thing is one wrong thing too many. So, you know, doubting yourself and questioning yourself and having that thirst to want to learn more or educate through these courses, YouTube videos, books, that's the right approach. Anybody that feels that they know enough and they just can improvise, those are the owners that are gonna have a lot more problems on their boats than the owners that doubt themselves to embed their knowledge. So just remember that whenever you're doing electrical, it's okay to question oneself and to look for the answer, as opposed to saying, well, I think I got this, and then just doing it. Because if you do it and it's wrong and there's only a right answer, you're gonna find yourself in big trouble, especially when you go offshore or if you actually use your boat, which most of us are planning on doing. I mean, and that's the big difference. Most, a lot of boaters just have a boat and leave it at the dock. But for the rest of us that actually plan on using it and leaving the dock, you're going to find yourself where reliability and safety is really important. So a little bit about me. My background, I'm an engineer. I never thought when I was doing engineering that I would actually practice in this field. I did systems design, and you'll see that's going to be a big focus. I don't get really caught up about a lot of the intricacies of how one thing works. I really worry in a boat about how everything works together. And that's really the big takeaway that when we do work on boats is seeing how everything, all the pieces, end up working in concert or together to make a whole, as opposed to knowing everything about one thing and not understanding how another thing works with something else. Because on a boat, it really is truly a system for electricals. Some of you mentioned, and I think this is really important, whenever you do work, there are standards out there. Boaters tend to be very creative people that tend to go on their own path, and that's probably what attracts a lot of us. There is no road to go somewhere. You choose the road you want to go somewhere on a boat. Be very careful that you don't take that navigation approach to charting your own course and inventing your own way of doing electrical. Right? And that is, to be honest, all too common, where people that have boats feel that they know better than everyone else. And that's okay in life, but in electrical, again, there are a lot of good reasons why things have been standardized. So I would always encourage someone, before they throw away the code, especially until they get to that expert level where they can question and talk about the pros and cons of the code, it's probably much easier to just follow the code than try to invent your own version of doing electrical. And that's where ABYC comes in. The other thing too, you might have, for now 7 years, we've been writing articles every month in Pacific Yachting, and that's something that I really like about connecting with boaters. And then, like I said, I wanted a boat, graduated university in 2002, bought a boat in 2006 before a house, which was insane financially, but it gave me a business in the end, because my boat electrically was passed as good from the surveyor, and the surveyor told me my electrical system was good, and I assumed that good meant good, but I found out very quickly that good isn't, that's not the case, and my boat failed and failed and failed electrically, and I lost vacation time. I had disappointments after disappointments, and that really was the genesis of just having this quest to solve electrical and to make sure that my boat's electrical systems were reliable and safe. And in the end, what that enabled me to have is to start this business, which we started in 2007. So just a little bit to get you a sense of why I'm here in front of you. PYS, or my outfit, is focused strictly just on electrical and electronic systems. Just to give you an idea of the, we don't do everything on a boat. I think boats are complicated enough, so we tend to focus on one area. The other thing too is we service boats here and everywhere, but that geography doesn't matter so much. What's interesting about this, and I think this is where, and you should certainly do that when you leverage, is leverage other people's experience. Like in our outfit last year, we worked on 600 boats. And what's important about that is you get, I think, expertise through repetition. And so if you're going to do something on your boat, don't just figure it out on your own. There's nothing wrong with doing it yourself, but leverage, you know, the community of boaters that have worked on so many boats. Read about people's experiences on forums. Read books. Come to these seminars. Read articles, right? It's okay to figure stuff on your own, but you want to figure stuff on your own leveraging all these experiences that are out there so that you learn from their mistakes. Because that's really what the experiences teach you, is that the pitfalls of doing things the wrong way so that you don't end up doing them, reliving these mistakes that don't need to happen. All right. This goes without saying, but with electrical, the big thing, especially with 12 volts, is that it might burn, yes, But really the big issue is a fire, right? Especially with 12 volt. So I'm not so much concerned working on a 12 volt system about burning. It's not gonna kill you, but it could cause a fire. And a fire on a boat is pretty serious. There's not that many exits on a boat, especially on a sailboat. And where you are and where the fire is gonna start, you might be in the forward cabin and the fire happens right on an electrical panel, right under the companionway, right? So the only exit, easy exit out of your boat is where the fire is happening. That would never happen in a house. You're not gonna have a fire under a doorway in a house, right? You're gonna have the fire in electrical panels somewhere, but the doorway is not gonna have all the electrical system of your house that could catch on fire, and that's the only exit in and out. So again, this thing about, I'm not trying to create fear, but remember, electrical systems on a boat bring the safety level to another level in terms of exits. And so that's why I think it's even more important to care about safety on a boat than it would even on land. And work within your competence level. And I think that's something to be said. And you know, when I learned electrical systems for boats, even though I did an engineering degree, none of this was taught in school, really. And it didn't really make any sense anyways. It's not practical. All of our knowledge within all of the technicians that I have that actually were either educated here or built their skill sets here were learned on the job. For my technicians that come from Australia and New Zealand, where it's actually a real industry there, i.e. people learn it in school, there's full programs, you can't do what you want on a boat, you have to do it by code like on here on land, then those people actually learn a lot through the schooling process. But what's encouraging about what I'm trying to say there is that there is a lot of material within North America of people are doing it in a community. They're going out there and we're collectively all learning what needs to happen, because there's no easy way to become a marine electrician, right? It's something that is through osmosis and through collective experiences that's learned. So make sure that as you do more work on your boat, you're always feeling competent that you're doing the right thing. And then obviously what I mentioned a little bit earlier is don't invent your way of doing something. Really, more often than not, I've never been on a boat where I thought someone did something that didn't follow the code that was actually better. I've never seen it. People get themselves in a lot of trouble, you know, a lot of trouble. Yes, go ahead.
When you talk about, is there a place where you can read the ABYC code that it's like a single volume of something? Or
yeah, it's really unbelievable. Yeah, unbelievable. It's extremely dry. It's non-practical. The best way is to read a translation, which would be like a Nigel Calder or a Don Casey, or you need a translator. Effectively, you need a translator. Okay. Before we go into actually deal into the electricity, what I want to do is I'm going to take a little bit of, and I thought about this, I was thinking, before we start talking about electrons and everything else, I was thinking, you know, before we dive into the really dry stuff, let's start at the top and let's see what are things that are out there in the field on boats. And I'm going to go through a bunch of slides and I'm going to show you some pictures of what we see through electrical audits to show you the reality out in the field. And then that should kind of put a context to what we're going to be doing. And then after that, we're going to go into the dry. And once we cover the electrical contents of wiring, electrons, and volts, and amps, which realistically, I mean, it's relevant, but it's also, without context, hard to understand why it matters. I'm starting from the top. We're going to go back into the details, and then we're going to get ourselves back to the top. So I'm going to show you some images, and I want people here in the room to look and try to spot what are the anomalies of those pictures, because all of that is going to come through the course today. Anybody have any comments on what they're seeing on this image over here?
Moisture?
Okay. What else? Yeah. Wing nuts? Yeah, that's good. Notice on the negative, there's no heat shrink, right? There is on the positive. And notice it's an open-ended lug on the negative, right? So it's more in an automotive type of lug. Well, the reality is that that's actually not moisture. It's actually, you'll never find moisture on top of a battery. I've never seen it. It's really rare. It's not moisture. It's battery acid. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that is very worse. Yeah. So battery acids, why that happened? Either the battery got overfilled or it's overcharging. Why would it be overcharging? Many reasons. Maybe it's the age of the battery. The settings on the charger are wrong. Right? Remember, sulfuric acid is extremely corrosive. We'll talk about that a little bit later. And you need to have a container that actually is going to hold that battery acid, right? Because the battery acid will not evaporate. It's going to go down in the bottom of the container. And where is it going to go? Right? And some people, most battery boxes don't come with a manual. And most people don't read. And so they just do, right? Because do it yourself is not doing something without thinking. It's the act of educating and then doing. Most people get a battery box, doesn't come with a manual. They don't understand how they're going to stop that battery box from moving. So the first thing they do is they compromise the battery box and drill 4 holes in the bottom. And I am not joking, over 50-60% of all the boats out here have holes in the bottom of the battery box. Defeats the whole purpose of a battery box. But again, the battery box didn't come with a manual. When you buy anything electrically for a boat, you're not buying a wire and it comes with a book. You don't buy a connector and it comes with a book. There is no manuals that come with any of the products you buy. All those products work together, but you need to buy a real book to understand why all of this matters. So be very careful. All right, here's what do we see on this image?
Corrosion.
Actually, there's something out. What do you notice about?
Wrong connector.
Yeah, look at that. Look at that lug, right? Yellow lug. That's a 10-2, right? Look at what this owner decided to do. Yeah, and look how many strands of wire he fit in a 10-2. Why? And this is going to be a recurring theme today. This whole concept of getting it done. Just do it. Make it work. You're going to hear me say that over and over again. That's absolutely non-acceptable on a boat. This was an owner that probably didn't have the right terminal and just went through the exercise and said, I'll deal with that later. Right, this is a 20-amp breaker, and there's 3 strands on that breaker. 3 strands go into that lug. What about this? Can you guys see that? It's hard to see. This is electrical tape. Yeah. And it's not a terminal. It's literally a bolt and a nut in midair with electrical tape. Notice they're using heat shrink terminals, but not trunk. Do you know how often I see people that buy the most expensive terminals and don't understand that actually without heat, the whole purpose of that terminal is wasted? And even so-called professionals don't understand that they actually need to apply heat, or they can't be bothered because they don't have time. In life, to do something well takes a lot more time than to do something quickly, right? So take the time to do things properly. So that owner had, literally, there's 6 connections here on a single nut, midair suspended with electrical tape, no heat shrink applied, just floating.
So how should it be mounted?
It should be brought to a terminal strip, bus bar. Right? What about this? Now, you can actually, I mean, there's so many things that are wrong here. Notice the nut is barely treaded. Notice the amount of connections that are brought to a single terminal. And look, I mean, how many? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 terminals on 1 single lug. You know, when you think about terminals on a car battery, you know, how many circuits we have on a car battery? How many terminals do we have on a car battery? There's 2 wires. That's a positive and a negative. Now, do you think your car only runs on 2 wires? And there's only 1 appliance and it's only the engine? Maybe the starter? Absolutely not. Everything goes to distribution point, right? And when you think about electrical, you actually think about, the analogy I use all the time is a tree. And it's actually really accurate and probably not a coincidence that people talk about branch circuits and trunk circuits, right? And everything starts at the root, at the battery, and then it goes up big wires, smaller wires, right? But not all the branches of a tree are growing in the ground, right? There's a trunk, right? So you have trunk lines, and then it goes to distribution, and then sub-distributions. People do this because it's the easiest conceptual thing to do, is to bring all the connections to the battery. They don't understand the panel. They don't know what's going on in the panel. The panel's too complicated. I'm just going to bring it back to the battery. If I bring it back to the battery, I know I've got a negative. And I don't know what a negative looks like in the panel, so I'm not going to do that. No boat builder would ever do this. This is a do-it-yourself that doesn't want to look at the panel. It's too complicated, too far away, and starts bringing all the connections over time, to the point where the nut is barely fitting on.
So what's the worst that could happen, the second worst?
Well, first of all, if you've got eight connections, and that's why ABYC, you're not going to have a really good connection. So you're going to have crazy voltage drop, right? The other thing, too, is the nut on a boat. Remember, a boat is not a home. It vibrates, right? There's vibrations. There are harmonics on a boat, especially when the engine is running. I've been on boats where, like, half of all the nuts on top of the batteries are actually gone. They've actually unwinded themselves, fell down the battery box. I've had an owner on a huge boat, a 65-footer, where he had 12 golf cart batteries, and only four of them were still running because the jumpers had actually, because big wires have a tendency, they're not slack, right? They don't stay where they are. They want a baby bend, right? And so they had lifted up, and eight of his golf cart batteries were actually being unused because the nut had undone itself, and the batteries were in a hard-to-reach place, and he assumed that batteries are just batteries and never looked. Now, that's losing a battery in terms of functionality is not a big deal. What is a big deal is imagine if that jumper actually moved around and shorted itself. Then you'd lose the boat. There's no other way around it. Here's something else, and that's all too common, especially here in the wintertime when we're using AC. That's actually, you can see actually, the burn is so, that's actually from the receptacle on the boat. The pin melted from the boat side receptacle and actually came out. If you ever go to, they have a wall like that at actually Fisherman's, right? Or I haven't been there in a couple of years, but they had literally a panel of just all these shore power receptacles that had melted. So really important if you've got one of those, you know, if you see any sign of corrosion, and it's common, and it won't happen generally in the summer when you're not really using your AC system, because your AC system is just running a charger in the summer. What are you going to be really running, right? A few things. But think about how you're running a heater nonstop in the winter for extended periods of time. In the summer, you might be using it for your stovetop, your charger, your hot water, but at one point, the AC loads are gonna diminish. Heat is one thing that is pretty much continuous. And so what happens is you've got a 30 amp shore power receptacle and you're running maybe 25 amps, 28 amps, 23 amps, right? And you're running that nonstop, 24/7. And so any sign of corrosion, and this is a vicious cycle with electrical, right? So if you've got resistance causes heat, heat causes resistance, and it's a domino effect, spiraling effect. So corrosion, we're going to talk about that a little bit later. I don't know if you can see it just because of the light. This here is a midair floating distribution point from this wire over here. This is actually just simply in suspension. And look how many terminals are on this nut and bolt. Completely exposed, we've got what? No caps on top of the battery. Look at the wire, it actually is running in between one large terminal and the other. Notice there's no fusing on any of these wires. Right? This would be a before and after. All right, what about over here? What do you see? First of all, you see this is a stereo, and you know it's a stereo because of this here. Notice what they did. Got buck connectors here, an inch, more buck connectors, right? Look at this one. Going to another one. Three butt connectors in a row. Really important. We're going to be talking about how every connection point is a point where you can bring in resistance, right? Resistance causes voltage drop. Voltage drop means things don't work when your battery voltage isn't as high as it normally is. So then you start to have intermittent problems. Intermittent problems will drive the crew of a boat insane. Because now it starts being like magical until you figure out the pattern. Right? But without a pattern, it's really disappointing, and you get really concerned when your GPS works sometimes, and sometimes it doesn't. It's easy to have something not working. Having something that comes on and off, depending on situations, until you figure out that pattern, is really a cause of concern for many boaters. This is another one here. Look at the number of butt connectors on one circuit, at six in a row. Okay, so what do we see in this picture? So this is a bilge, and we're bilge pump.
Butt connectors unprotected.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. Nope. What was that? Somebody said something?
It could be in the water.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's right. Can you imagine? Remember your bilge pump. There's an auto and there's a manual, right? So you can't have a positive connection sitting in a high water. Can you imagine what this type of circuit you're going to have? Nigel Calder has extreme examples of that happening, where people lose literally their rudder stock. The rudder falls right out of the ocean, like right in the ocean. He talks about these craziness that happens based on positive wiring in the bilge. So if you're going to do a bilge, you know, there's no reason why, and that's why the bilge pump has enough of a pigtail, you can bring it a little higher, right? Put it on a terminal strip much higher, or, you know, if it can't go high enough, then at least use heat shrink connections and bring it as high as humanly possible to so that make sure that it's never going to be standing in water. Now, this one is a little hard to see because of the light, but I just want to show you, and this was one of the most craziest things I saw. This is an inverter. Actually, it's right here. You can actually see, this is actually a Freedom inverter charger. You can see the blue. We're on a grounding wire here, okay? This is a chassis ground wire. And I've got a multimeter set up right now, and you can see at the top it's an A, and it's reading 12.17 amps. On this boat, he paid someone to do this. The path from the inverter back to shore power was actually, there was no path. They simply installed a battery bank, an inverter battery bank. They did not ground that battery bank to the engines or to the panel. It was a standalone battery bank. But what they didn't realize is by not grounding that battery bank to the rest of the boat, when they would be running the alternators, the current for the alternator output to recharge the battery, because they connected the positive, right? A lot of people don't understand that currents need a circuit, right? I had that on my boat from the previous owner. He increased the alternator size, increased the wire from the alternator, but only the positive. And that's all too common. People think always just about positive, and they assume that the negatives are fine. And so what was happening is actually the alternator return path to recharge that battery bank was happening on the grounding wire. The grounding wire was actually so melted that at both ends, it was like someone had smoked it. And the fuse would never blow, because the fuse on the ACRs was set for 150 amps. Luckily, the alternators were stock alternators, and they were only outputting about 30 amps. But they were using the chassis ground as a return path to charge that inverter bank while the engines were running. What do you people see here on this image?
Fuse.
Yeah, a fuse. Use where?
Linked directly to the battery.
That's right. Yeah, you see, that's a Class T fuse. They put dielectric grease on it, though. That's pretty awesome. You know? They really did care. They put a fuse held midair. All of this is positive, by the way. And notice the wing nut is literally a thread in. No, you can't. You really can't. I mean, it's a thread in. I was just imagining there was a champagne or beer moment when he got that nut one thread in. He's like, my job here is done. I did it. I thought I wasn't going to be able to. People said it couldn't be done, but I proved them wrong. This is very thick, by the way. I mean, it's a Class D fuse. It's probably, you know, not half a centimeter, but probably four mils probably. So he has a 4 mil connection point on top of one and two. There's already two lugs there. And then he's like, I need to get that Class T fuse in there, and I don't want to buy a block. So if I can just fit it in with a wing nut, I'm set. And this is the circuit for the inverter, right? What's this?
Inside of the battery.
Yeah. Well, what else do we see inside the battery? Should the inside of a battery look like this? Yeah. And what else, though? That's right, it's dry, but what else are we seeing? Buckled, right. I had 2 weeks ago, two clients, two service calls, batteries exploded on the boat. Bring the boat, one to Shelter Island, one to Lionsgate. Clients had not serviced the boats. The plates were dry. They had buckled. And so what happens is almost buckled, and as they were charging running the alternators, they were recharging the battery, causing gassing. The battery box now is full of hydrogen, right, as opposed to only the top end. The plates are exposed, so when they're going to short, they're going to create a spark. Literally, the battery box container, the hatch, this was one of them when it was on the North Pacific, the hatch actually exploded up from the back. That's how strong the explosion. It actually broke the hatch mechanism. One of the hinges actually popped from an 8D exploding because the 8D battery had not been serviced. So be very, very careful, especially with flooded lead acid batteries. And here's another example. What do you guys see up at the top there? Yeah. That's burnt. That's a bad crimp on a neutral tie. Right, so bad connections cause heat. Heat causes resistance. And over time, that vicious cycle happens. And look, it causes so much heat that this is actually a tin wire. But notice the corrosion. The tin actually is gone. Like, this is now bare copper, which is under the tin wire. And it's actually, look at that. The insulation of the wire has actually melted over. Even the connector itself is completely tarnished. Here's something else. We've got a lug, again, dielectric grease applied. What else can you see here that would not be right about this picture? Yeah, outside of the lug. Yeah.
No heat shrink.
No heat shrink.
Some of the wires aren't even connected. They could be broken off.
Right. And the other thing, too, is you can barely see it in this image, but there's barely a dimple in that lug. You know how, because let's say our shop, we use these big, big crimpers. Right, and they'll actually melt the wiring. There's so much pressure PEV equals NRT from chemistry, that the pressure is so high that actually the temperature increases and the wires are actually going to weld. This owner did it himself, used, you know, the hammer, nothing wrong with that, you know, use the tool, but barely got a dimple into that. So that wire is there, but very easy to take out, right? Especially when you've got, especially with electrical, what's interesting is that a lot of people are satisfied when it's working, but they don't realize that working is not an on or off thing. It could be, it's working at low amperage, right? Because you could have an inverter that's just giving you running a light. But what happens if you're running an inverter and that inverter is now running a coffee pot or a microwave or inductive oven, right? Then now it's drawing 300 amps, it's not drawing 10 amps. So that connection worked fine at 5 or 10 amps, but now that it's a bad connection and now you're drawing 200 amps, what's going to happen, right? So I often see inverters where the jacket here, we were on a boat in West Van 2 weeks ago, the insulation here was all smoldered to the point that it looked again like a cigarette. It was all pulled back, completely black, because it was a bad crimp. What do we see on this image? A lot of corrosion. Lots. That boat actually, the DC electrical, and there was a flooding on that boat, and the bus bar was below water. You can actually see all the pitting started happening. Notice that the pitting only happens on the positive. Look at the negative right beside it. Perfectly fine. This was an inverter install. What do we see that's wrong with this image? What else?
That's supposed to be a fuse?
It is. The fuse blew.
Oh, okay. So it's jumped it.
Yeah. Just put a coin in an electrical panel, right? Make a circuit. The fuse was blowing. And that was kind of a bother. So he decided to forego the fuse. And that's a fuse holder. That's a Class D fuse holder. Took the fuse out and just moved it direct connection on an inverter circuit, which is probably one of the, I mean, if you're going to care, an inverter is going to be one of those appliances you're going to care about, like a windlass. You don't not fuse, you can't not fuse a windlass. You have to fuse your inverter. Isn't that neat? It's beautiful, isn't it? I thought that's almost like, it's almost like jewelry. Yeah, that was the battery that there's tons of overcharging. Here's another one. This you can actually tell. This is an inverter. What do you see in that picture on the inverter that maybe stands out? Anybody can notice?
Telephone wire.
Telephone wire is fine because the telephone wire is between the remote panel and the inverter.
Household wiring.
Yeah. Yeah. Now notice, do you see what this is?
Ground wire.
Yeah. Notice that wire here. That's a gauge 10. Look what they did. Do you see this wire right here? Look at that. That's 2-aught coming to a point here. The installer didn't realize that the factory, they had pre-wired it and screwed it on the ground so that the next installer was going to find it. And the installer was supposed to take that connection and bring it to here and take that lug off and fit it here. That cable had slack. What the installer then thought, didn't realize, didn't read, because most people don't like reading, right, remember? He thought, well, oh, there's 2-aught over there. I'm going to use a gauge 10 wire between here and there. And I mean, that's a big issue because you've got a weak point. You know, if you've got a chain and it's 5/16th link, if you put a tiny little link there, that's 1/16th of an inch, it doesn't matter how big everything else is, the weak point in the system is actually what's going to cause the failure. So basically, this defeated the whole purpose of a chassis ground, right? Because the code says it needs to be one size smaller than the largest cable feeding the inverter. And the builder actually pre-wired it for that. Everything about what the pre-builder had done was great, the installer didn't understand what they were doing, and so they just created a little jumper wire between the two points.
So why didn't the builder hook it up in the right place?
Because the builder doesn't put an inverter. They pre-wired it, but the inverter is a commissioning item. They made it easy to expand, so it's pre-wired, but no inverter included, which makes sense because the wiring takes time. And so some owners might choose a pure sine wave, some owners might choose modified sine wave, right? And they want to keep the build price low, and then those are commissioning options. Can you guys see how deep that nut, the amount of treads, and the willpower that was required to actually get all three of those connection points on this? Can you imagine the amount of pressure? I mean, this was a two-person operation. There's no way one person could keep that level. That's four-aught cables. I mean, they're not slack, right? They want to be somewhere where the battery, and they're not staying there. So you need a hand on that with a lot of pressure, another hand on here, not really a hand on this, and then you need a lot of determination to be able to pull one thread onto that nut. I mean, that takes some serious skill. Here's a shot of an inverter. You remember that smoldering that I was talking to you about? This is a client that ended up using undersized wires, and look at that. I've seen sometimes 4 inches deep. Okay, this one is crazy. Now that one is really, really scary.
Fuse.
Yeah. Fuse, yeah, it's a fuse holder. Yeah.
Cooked.
It's cooked. Now, does it look partially cooked or a little cooked?
Right. Yeah.
We're going to talk about that later. This was a fuse holder installed for underwater lights on a really nice boat, a 44-foot Tierra, professionally installed. The lights were, but the person doing the electrical was the same person who did the underwater lights, so then you're starting to have jack of all trades, right? Like underwater lights, electrical, they're kind of unrelated. There's a lot of lights in the circuit. And the installer figured, well, why put four fuses for four lights? I'm just going to daisy chain them. And so then he ended up putting one fuse for all four underwater lights, right? Because that saves time. So he's being good to the owner. He's saving them money. Believe it or not, the load was so great on that fuse that the fuse melted short. It did not even open. So, you know, it'd be like driving a car and having a seatbelt and saying, I'm going to be reckless because I have a seatbelt. A fuse will not always save you. It's meant to, but sometimes it can actually fail and not do anything. It actually fails closed, meaning that fuse didn't melt and actually open the circuit. It was such a huge amount of current going through there that it melted itself together, and then the wire in the bundle on the wiring harness back to the battery melted, and it melted other wires in the wiring bundle. And that's how we got called in. So that's really scary. It means that when you're doing electrical, it's not because you have a seatbelt and airbags in your car that you can just simply go willy-nilly and do anything you want, right? Because you could find yourself where the safety mechanism, the one thing that's supposed to save you, is actually not going to do what you intended or hoped it was going to do. There's so much going on. I love that picture. Yeah, first thing, that's right. And that goes back to, for troubleshooting, how do you figure what's what, right? That's a big problem. Chaos is normal, right? Order isn't. So that's the reason why electricians are really particular about having everything in place. Because as soon as something falls out of place, you see it. How would you see anything out of place here? when you start off with this. Now, I'm going to start showing what's going on here because it truly is crazy. This charger, first of all, is floated. It's actually just on the ground. Luckily, let's note, there's an anti-skid mat, so it's not going to move around too much. So they put it in on a mat that, yeah, it's laying flat on the hall, but I mean, it's not super slippery. No, it's not installed. It's on an anti-skid mat. So that's the first thing that's pretty amazing about that. I mean, they did care. Notice, this is a 40 amp charger. Look at the size of the wire coming out on one of those terminals. That's a gauge 16, 18 on a 40 amp charger. Look at this wire. It's tiny, tiny. They installed the temperature sensor, and that's right here. But notice where the temperature sensor is. It's lying beside the charger, and they didn't install that temperature sensor where it needs to go. The reason there's a hole is it's battery temperature sensor. So they connected it, but didn't actually install it. Okay, we're going to talk about that. That's, oh yeah, this is good. Talk a little bit about, we might have time to talk a little bit about corrosion. What do you see? Do you see this? What is this in the water? That was a Thunderbird. This is the water. This is a swim grid. This is a zinc, actually two zincs. Hey, good, right? Two is better than one, right? Connected. Notice the quality of these zincs. These zincs are special. They're amazing zincs. They'll last forever, right? No, it's true. These are magic zincs, right? The owner is probably thinking, these are the best zincs I ever bought, right? No, this is a special zinc. You should get those zincs. Let me show them to you. After 4 years, they still look the same. Unrelated, my underwater metals are all gone, but these zincs are just truly amazing. Bungee cord? Is a bungee cord electrical? Is it conductive?
So there's no wire running through it.
And then, well, there's no wire. I mean, this is the conductor right here, is the bungee cord. Going to an insulated, obviously, hook. Going to a dinghy davit, which is not grounded. So this is the definition of not a circuit. This is not a circuit. Okay? I saw that, and this is an expensive boat in Thunderbird, where moorage is quite expensive, right? I saw that, I was like, my heart just went, it stopped, and I was like, seriously?
I'm confused, what was the point of all that?
There is no point. The owner, his intent. What was his intent? He was trying to add more zincs, because some people aren't diving frequently or changing their zincs on their props. He probably had it, because it's a power boat, he probably had a diver's dream that he didn't want to haul out the boat for. Right. And so the owner was trying to zinc his boat.
Gotcha.
Right.
What about just laying a zinc in through the winter, like at the docks at Burrard, and a lot of boats?
Yeah, a lot, yeah. But you need a path. Yeah, but you need a path back. And also, yeah, that was his idea. Yeah, idea.
With the bungee cord.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. All right, we're almost done looking at the craziness out there. What do you guys see? I wrote an article in Pacific Yachting about this. What do we see? What are we looking at? First of all, it's a panel, right? And it shows us that it's inverting, so it's an inverter charger, right? It's a Magnum, really good. That's a temperature sensor. Yeah, good point. Battery temperature sensor, 151 Celsius. That would be hot, right? Right? The lesson here is, in life, there's very few shortcuts that pay off. That's the lesson. So, here you had an owner that had a Xantrax Freedom inverter charger, modified sine wave. decided that it was time, and we'll talk about inverters later, time to go to a true sine wave inverter charger. So for multiple reasons, we'll talk about why. And when it was time to take out the inverter charger, it looks like it's a easy in, easy out, right? You take the inverter charger, you put a new one in. The temperature sensor that is bought with the Xantrax inverter charger has the same plug, phone jack terminal plug, as a Magnum one. They both have a phone jack connection. But what the installer didn't realize is that the resistance of the Magnum inverter or Xantrax temperature sensor and the Magnum one aren't the same. He assumed they were the same. So he saved the owner the hassle of rerunning a new temperature sensor, saying, we'll reuse the Xantrax one because I'm going to save you money. I don't have to run a wire back to the batteries to sense the temperature. So saves the owner maybe 2 hours, 3 hours of time to run a wire between the batteries. On this boat, it was a Hunter, so it's kind of hard. But what the installer didn't realize is now the temperature sensor for the Xantrax and the Magnum were so off that Magnum thought that the batteries were in a complete over temp condition, and they weren't. This was always 151. So guess what the inverter charger did on that boat? Shut itself down, barely charged, thinking, I'm going to do something, but I'm barely going to do something because the batteries are in thermal runaway. This, by the way, is coincidentally the highest temperature that the batteries could ever possibly be in. They don't go higher than 151. I mean, that's what they're doing. Yes?
So the temperature, not actually at that temperature.
Nope. Yeah, it was a wrong sensor because the phone jacks were the same. They assumed. So then that battery bank was an AGM battery bank, Lifeline batteries, slimline, 700 apiece, six of them. After a year, the batteries were completely dead because they never got charged. So the owner lost six batteries, $4,200. Plus the time to take them out and in, and not understanding why they failed in the first place, right? That takes time. I mean, why did brand new AGM batteries fail, right? So remember, there are no shortcuts in life. And only experts take shortcuts, right? It's like in the backcountry. You stay on the trail. You don't go North Shore hiking and go, hey, you know, grouse grind. Screw that. Just going to go a little bit to the left. There's nobody. What could happen, right? Same thing with electrical. You have to stay on track. Don't take shortcuts. If the manual says do this, then do it. If it comes with a temperature sensor, it takes more time, don't assume. Run a new one. And that was a really expensive mistake. Now, we're almost done with these images. What do you see on this picture?
A fuse.
Well, before we go that, yes, it is a fuse block. Noted, but right. What do we see here? This I saw this on a pretty nice boat actually. This is an inverter. So this is a fuse block, right? This is a Class T fuse block. We have what looks to be a positive cable because it's red here, and then it's got a red head shrink. Now they install red here, and that, by the way, doesn't mean it's positive because some people buy just black wire and red heat shrink and they kind of label positive in red and they assume you'll know. So you can't always assume, right? This, you're pretty sure that the person knew what they were doing. But here, you don't know. You think they knew, but they don't. So that looks positive to me, right? Pretty sure. We're not sure, but it looks positive. And this looks pretty, we can't see the cabling, you can barely see it here. This looks negative. What would happen if someone put a fuse in that fuse holder? That's right, it'd be a dead short. Can you imagine the current that would go through that wire if you were holding a metal fuse in your hand and putting that in? How, like, you'd be, like, it'd be Raiders of the Lost Ark and the medallion in the hand. You'd have a Class T fuse part of your hand. It'd be like, hi, oh, Class T? Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah, no big deal. It's part of my experience. The owner hadn't done this, we came on board, did an electrical audit, and so someone had reutilized a Class T fuse bar as a distribution post. And actually, look at the separation between this. This is barely an inch. Imagine someone working with a tool here, right?
I should have a cover on it.
Of course, but a cover, you can't even, you should have absolutely an insulator between those two points. So what's the lesson here? The lesson is, don't improvise, right? Here's someone that went and probably said, well, I've got a Class D fuse bar. Why can't I use it? I'm going to save the hassle. I'm not going to go buy a positive one and a terminal and a negative one. You know, I have it. It works. But the problem with that is that unless you really know what you're doing, it takes you a while to understand what you're seeing. And a next owner or someone that's working under duress is going to be, oh, there's missing a fuse here, right? Right? It's not crazy. You have to know what you're looking at, right? So when you take a shortcut or you deviate from the norm, think about all, are you always going to remember what you did? Right? Because this is going to be there for 5, 10 years. You might have your boat for 15 years. So you're always going to remember what you did, the shortcut you took. And is everyone going to know that you took a shortcut? And what happens when you sell the boat or somebody else works on the boat and you have a technician or a friend or someone's helping you do stuff on the boat and you're troubleshooting an inverter that's not working and somebody's helping, oh, look, there's missing a fuse. No problem, undoes it. Assumes it's a fuse holder. It is. Puts a fuse in, completely burns his hand. I mean, imagine the current going through a positive and negative on a dead short. I mean, it'd be crazy. Your hand would be seared. It'd be third-degree burns, right? So it's not related to electrical, but this goes to always doubt. Where are we here? If people can notice, this is the Copelands, right? We're going to Desolation Sound. We've just passed Lund, right? Sarah Point is further up. My radar does not lie, right? Radar can't lie. It is what it is. So I'm in the middle of the channel right now. You can tell from the radar. I'm clearly in the middle of the channel. But look at my GPS. So for all of those people that say you don't need a radar at night because my GPS charts are going to tell me how to get there, you know, everything's fine, GPS is accurate, I got this, and you're in limited visibility or there's fog, right? I was navigating with my eyes in the middle of the channel. My radar confirmed that I was in the middle of the channel, but my charts told me I was way too close. So I would have come in here, right? And then I would probably hit this island. So, oh, it's very little. Copeland's, that is tiny. This is the channel. This is probably less than, honestly, not even 100. It's not 100 meters. It's probably 50 meters, maybe 75 meters. And you can tell, I mean, here, it looks like I'm on shore, right? My GPS is telling me I'm on shore. I need to move hard over. Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is. And this is local waters. This is not far away place where the charts were built in 1840 or something like that in an expedition and they haven't been updated and there's reefs moving and, you know, coral heads and all this other stuff. This is local BC. And so the point what I try to do that, even though it's not electrical, is that, you know, never assume, you know, you want to have redundancy. You want to have always doubt, always question, right? Because you can't put too much faith into one thing. All right, so it's 10:45, so we're going to start the break, about 10, 15 minutes, and then we're going to go into the drier stuff, and we're going to start building up our knowledge so that we can understand how we don't have all of this stuff happen. Okay?